Hi everyone, we think we're live now. We've been working on it. We've done this 8 times. Of course, the last time is when we have technical difficulties.
Yeah.
And we're trying to get it. But welcome to our Marriage Corner. This is number 8 of an 8-week series. Tonight actually is going to be our last night doing this for a while. We'll see what happens.
For now, yes.
Yeah. If you have some ideas, thoughts of other things we could do, other topics we can cover, house painting, woodwork, I don't know, things we know nothing about. But thank you for joining us and being part of this. And Angie and I both believe that as we build a great marriage, as we walk with God, that our marriage will be better and better. And as you can see, I'm Lowell, this is my wife Angie, and we are ministers with the Charleston Church of Christ, and we also teach and believe in having a very, very strong marriage. One thing I want to encourage you to do is, if you're watching us, then you're on Facebook, and just get on there and hit the share button so others can enjoy it, or make fun of us, whichever it may be. Hopefully they'll enjoy it. But tonight we're going to talk about apologies, reconciliation, and forgiveness.
And before that, as is our custom, we do have a question that we want to ask you, because it helps us to get to know you better and spend some time interacting with you. Since, like Law said, it's definitely different talking into a camera and not actually seeing you. Mm-hmm. But we have a question here. We are hoping to have some fun, and we hope you can leave some comments. So the question is, would you rather mentally age or physically never age? Would you rather mentally never age or physically never age?
That's a great question.
So that's a it's a challenging question. I don't know. I was trying to think about, you know, which I would rather, and I don't know. I couldn't come to any conclusion. What about you?
The amazing thing is, hon, you don't do either. You don't mentally age. I'm serious. And you physically never age. It's incredible.
I don't know if that's a compliment. Oh, mentally never age.
Our new newlyweds are on here.
Oh, that's my awesome goodness. Just got married last Saturday. The Parnells, Matt and Sheila Parnell.
Congratulations, Matt
Welcome.
And Sheila. That's
it's
great.
Great to have you on. Amen. Hopefully, you do not have to apologize to each other yet, but this will be a great class. So, Steve Botter said he would rather never age mentally. Oh, okay. So
Steve,
did Claudia.
It's
Claudia
too late,
said the
Steve.
Same.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
So, Londra said physically never age. Well, she said physically. Dana said howdy. So, amen. Jean, mentally never age.
Wow. Sharon goes for physically. Okay.
Ronnie, physically? Really?
It's a tough question, isn't it?
His mind is shot. What can you say?
Like, if I knew I was going to get Alzheimer's, or if I was going to decline mentally, well, yeah, I guess. I don't know.
I like Joanne. Joanne, you're smart. She said she didn't want to age mentally, because then she could figure out how to physically not age.
I like it. Now that is very smart. That you have
smart.
Not aged mentally, Joanne,
no,
for
not.
Sure.
You're still 6.
So again, if you are just joining us, welcome. This is, like Law mentioned, our last series in the Marriage Corner. We will be returning with something else. And actually, if you have some more ideas of what we can do, please do let us know. We appreciate all the input that you give us. And also, please remember to hit that share button so others can know that we are on as well. But like Law said, we are going to be talking about apologizing, reconciliation, and forgiveness today. Now, if we live in a perfect world and never sinned, then we would absolutely have no need for this class, and certainly no need to ever apologize. But that's not the case. We are not perfect.
What?
We don't have perfect spouses. I mean, you don't have perfect spouses. I have a perfect spouse. It's you. And we don't all have perfect marriages. So absolutely, we need this class. I know I need this class. You probably don't.
No,
honey,
I need it.
But I need it.
I need it.
And my guess is that probably most of you need this class
Even Matt
as well.
And Sheila may need it. They just got married a few days ago.
I hope not, but hope not. You will.
That's right.
And conflict is definitely an inevitable part of marriage. We are not yet like Jesus. We are different genders. We think mm-hmm. differently. We have different upbringings, different backgrounds. Maybe we grew up even in different continents like mm-hmm. we have. And it certainly is a myth to believe that good marriages are relatively free of conflict. Mm-hmm. That is not true. Yeah. It is a myth. At some point, you have had and you will have conflict. At some point, you have and you are going to have a spouse that is upset with you, that's angry with you because you've offended them, because you've done or said something that has really hurt them and that they consider to be wrong. And maybe you've even hurt the trust in your relationship. And when that happens, the relationship gets fractured and it's difficult, maybe even impossible, to get back to having a loving relationship if there is no apology, if there is no reconciliation, and if there is no forgiveness. You know, when there's been hurt on the inside, we cry out for reconciliation. Yeah. I don't know about you, but if Lo and I are not on the same page and we're not one, I just yearn to be close to Lo. I just yearn and desire so much to be one with him. And it's almost like you have this torn feeling, though. It's like you want reconciliation so that you can be one, but then you also want justice and you want a sincere apology. That's me anyway. Mm-hmm. That's how I function. And yet the reluctance to apologize seems to be rooted into so many of us, rooted into us since we've been very young.
Yeah.
I remember, I don't know if you remember this, but
I don't know
one
is.
Of our kids was just a toddler.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember, okay,
this
she,
child.
Everybody's gonna know who it is. But I remember she refused as a toddler to apologize and say she is sorry about something she did.
Really?
And we put her in timeout, sitting on her chair. And she sat there for hours as a toddler, just refusing to say that she was sorry. And I think that can be so many of us. And really, how we react to conflict and how we react to even saying apologies is heavily influenced by what we saw when we were growing up, what we internalized when we were growing up. Perhaps you were raised in a household where apologies were seldom uttered. Mm. And if so, you have not learned to own up to your own mistakes. You know, if you are a parent, I would encourage you to teach your children how to apologize, to let them hear you and see you apologize to your spouse and even to them. If you haven't had practice as a child apologizing, you are going to find it very difficult as an adult to offer apologies. So parents, make sure you are teaching this to your children.
Teach it.
Now, while a sincere apology can go a long way in mending a relationship, it's amazing how as married couples, we are often so unwilling to be able to take the step and
What's
apologize.
What is wrong with
I
us?
I don't know. What is it? It's like, I don't know if you've experienced this, but I definitely have. It's like it sticks in your throat. It's like, it's in your head. You know, it might be in your head, but it just, just doesn't come out.
You just have to throw up that apology.
I don't know. Just, whatever.
Right.
Or, but gotcha. Maybe you quickly dive into blame mode. I've never done that. I'm kidding, kidding. Okay, don't give me that look. But maybe you've never, maybe you just quickly dive into blame mode, or you turn cold and stony, or you deny that you've ever, ever done anything wrong, or maybe you give some quick, weak apology. Whatever. However, the key is for all of us to give a genuine apology. Admitting you are wrong can be difficult and, yes, humbling. And yet accepting the blame for our mistakes is such an opportunity for learning and for growing and for really being more like Jesus. Because when we apologize, we accept responsibility for our behavior. We seek to make amends with our spouse. And really, it opens the door for forgiveness and reconciliation, which Law is going to be talking about later on. But good marriages...
About an hour.
No, not that long. But good marriages are always marked by a willingness to apologize, to forgive, and to reconcile. And really, apologies should be viewed as a victory in our marriage. After all, a person who remains offended, the Bible says in Proverbs 18, is more unyielding than a fortified city. And truly, it is difficult, if not impossible, to restore peace in such a defensive atmosphere. On the other hand, when you apologize, you prevent the offense from becoming a barrier between you and your spouse. And in essence, what you are doing is you're putting your marriage ahead of yourself. So I wanted to talk a little bit about not just knowing when to apologize, but also knowing how to apologize.
Sorry.
Why? Do you think that's important?
I think it is important.
I think it is too. I think it'd be good. So we just want to give you some tips, and hopefully this will help you.
Yeah.
When or if ever, you know,
you may need
the time comes.
At least you'll have it there.
Yeah,
if you need
and
it.
You will need it, you know, so take notes. So a genuine apology has to come from the heart.
Yeah.
The goal of an apology is to heal the hurt and to restore the relationship. It's about expressing sorrow over what you've done and the hurt that you've caused your spouse. It's expressing to your spouse your own sense of guilt, acknowledging that your actions have hurt your spouse deeply. If you don't feel any remorse, your apology will fall flat. I know. I've been guilty of that, haven't I?
No.
Yeah, honey, I have. But I'm glad you can't remember.
Do you think you need to cry? Would it help to cry?
Huh? No, not with you. It doesn't get me anywhere. But
I'm moved.
Women, you can try it.
Right.
But with Law, it
I
doesn't.
I bet the guys, but
it doesn't really work.
True. Women could try crying too.
I wouldn't suggest that guys like run out of the room crying. No, that's not a good idea for
no.
the guys.
Stop it, Steve.
But what most of us look for in an apology, as I said, is sincerity. Expressing regret for what you said and for what you've done. You regret the pain that you've caused, the disappointment, the broken trust. If you could do it all over again, you would. You would say things differently. You wish you could take it all back. And really the focus is on what you failed to do, or on what you've done, which you shouldn't have done, or on how what you've done or said has affected your spouse. That's where the focus should be. Taking responsibility is so important, but it's also very important for the other spouse to know that you really are feeling bad about hurting them and you wish you hadn't. You wish you could take it all back. The offended spouse wants to know just how much they are hurting. And they want you to feel some of their pain. I know I tend to be like this. If I'm hurting, I want Law to know just how much I am hurting.
It's true.
What a what a sad victim I am.
What have I done?
But the offended spouse wants to know that you truly understand how much you've hurt them. And if there isn't that sense of regret, the apology could not even count. Apologizing for the sense of moving on is not going to work. I know I've done it where I've thought, okay, I'm just going to apologize so we can get over and done with this and we can move on. And that doesn't work.
No.
Using the words, I'm sorry and I was wrong when you apologize goes a long way. Your apology will most likely be heard and accepted if you use these words. Be specific about exactly what you did to hurt your spouse. When you are specific, the impact is greater. Saying, I'm sorry for whatever I did. Really, the more details you give about what you're sorry, the better it is. You know, we do it with our kids. I still remember with our kids, we used to do this all the time. They would say,
are you sorry, boy?
Okay, I'm sorry. And we would always go, okay,
what are you sorry for?
Fly. Lo's
trying to fly.
He's not hallucinating.
I'm not hallucinating.
And seeing stuff.
It's a fly coming from my
head. It drives him crazy to see a fly. Sincere apologies are needed in every type of relationship. And when they don't happen, anger really builds up. And that's when we feel like we need justice. And when we don't get it, what we tend to do is we tend to take things into our own hands. And then we even, sadly, we even seek to get revenge on our spouse. Our compassion just goes out of the window. And really, in marriage, a lot of pain and hurt is caused because of our pride, just not willing to sincerely apologize. Yeah. And that's pretty much declaring war in marriage. You know, examples of ways you shouldn't apologize.
Let's hear them. Lay them on me.
I know, I'm guilty of all of these.
No, you're not.
But saying stuff like, I'm sorry you feel that way.
That's lame.
Yeah, why do you think that's lame? What's up? What's wrong with that, honey? What do you think?
It's a backhanded apology. You're not really apologizing.
Exactly.
It's your fault.
You'd never say, I'm sorry you feel that way. Because you're blaming you're shifting the blame of, hey, you shouldn't feel that way. What's wrong with you? You shouldn't say, I'm sorry you took it that way.
Oh, boy.
I'm sorry I said it that way. You know, those kind of statements, and another one, yes, like, If I offended you. I am sorry. Never say if. Oh. If I offended you, I'm sorry. Because all those statements show lack of responsibility. And really, like we said, they point a finger of blame to your spouse. Another thing is that sincere regrets should stand alone and not followed by the word
But. No big buts.
No buts, big or small. You cannot accuse your spouse of causing you to lose it or blame them for provoking you. Man, if you hadn't made me mad, if you didn't say this, then I wouldn't have been ticked off and I wouldn't have lost it and I wouldn't have said that. This is your fault. I'm sorry, but... Those are just not good ideas. Mm. You're not going to get anywhere with that.
No.
Actually, you're going to cause more problems.
Mm-hmm.
I know.
Make more apologies.
Yes, exactly. But in the Bible, you know, we have great examples of people who blew it, who sinned, and their response is such a higher call for us. It's something for us to imitate. We have the prodigal son in Luke 15 who sinned so grievously against his father, against God. And his response is, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.
Yeah.
That's an example of a genuine apology. Or you think about David in 2 Samuel verse 12. When confronted about his sin, he says, I have sinned against the Lord. He made no excuses. He didn't blame shift. He just took responsibility. And lastly, for my part, When you say you are sorry, you cannot expect your spouse to apologize as well.
I used to do that.
Yes. We really...
That's why she said it real slow. Give me opportunity.
No. We really...
Like, I apologize really and...
Oh, honey, you only did that one time. No. And it was probably because I provoked you.
That's it.
So, but you just cannot expect your spouse
That's
to
right.
apologize
they
as
do,
well.
They do. If they don't, they don't.
Exactly. Your spouse may be moved and inspired to apologize for their actions as well, mm-hmm. but trying to evoke an apology from mm-hmm. the other person is just a manipulative tactic mm-hmm. that yes. sometimes actually backfires mm-hmm. because it's a form of manipulation to have it reciprocated. So when you apologize, do not apologize because you want to expect an apology in return. Mm. So now we're going to move on to the reconciliation and the forgiveness part. That's going to be...
Thank you very much, hon. That was awesome, awesome stuff. Mm. That was
if
great.
If only I could always remember it in the heat of the moment.
She
I'm
does,
sure you will remind me,
she
though,
She does
right?
practice what she preaches, for sure. She does.
Oh, that's very generous.
We, Angie, I do believe that this is the last of our series, and this... We say everyone is the most important, but this may be one of the most important. Trust, obviously, was huge. But if you can't reconcile, if you can't apologize, if you can't forgive, then your relationship will not be close. It will not continue. You may even be together, but you will not be close. You will not be one. So it is obviously very, very important to be able to forgive. And we believe that we got to forgive as God forgives us. Christians, if you are a Christian, if you claim to be a Christian, we should be the most forgiving people in the world.
Wow, that's true. Never thought about it.
You know why? Because we're the most forgiven people.
Forgiven, it's true.
We should understand what it means, how it feels, how much we need to be forgiven. Yet, if we're truly honest, in marriage of all places, it's one of the most challenging places to forgive.
Yeah, why do you think that is?
I don't know. I guess your spouse is, you trust your spouse more than anybody else in the world, and when they hurt you, you know, you feel like that you've been utterly and totally betrayed, and you want to hold on to it.
Violated.
And you feel justified doing it.
That's true.
So it's not always easy to forgive. We may say, I'll forgive him, but I will never forget this. That's not reconciliation.
Mm-mm.
That's probably not even forgiveness. You know, I'll forgive, but they're going to feel the cold shoulder. Really? You forgive it? Really? I forgive... but I'm going to lay it on them for a while. I mean, it that's not forgiveness. And it doesn't bring about reconciliation. Would you want to be forgiven as by God as you forgive others? See, we're called to forgive as God forgives us. Ephesians 4:32 says, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Bear with each other. And forgive one another. If any of you has any grievances against someone, how are we supposed to forgive? Well, we're not children. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. Would you want to be forgiven by God as you forgive your spouse? Would you want him to take that long? Would you want him to put you through that much stuff? Would you want him to, you know, maybe not forgive you or semi or kind of? You know, we got to forgive as God forgives us. Well, let's learn a couple of characteristics about forgiveness. One is forgiveness is not a feeling, but it's an act of our will. That is very important. You know, if we just waited till we felt like it, amen, maybe we'd get the sincere apology that Ange talked about. Maybe we wouldn't. I mean, think about it in your marriage. Have you always just, oh my God, I can't wait. I just can't wait to forgive. I'm just longing. I mean, no. If we waited until we felt like it, we may not do it. It's a decision of our will. There's two Greek words for forgiveness. The first one is aphiemai. Aphiemai. You read in Matthew 6 verse 12, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. Aphiemai us our debts. Matthew 18:27, The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. Then down in verse 32, then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said, I, a fee of mine, forgave all that debt of yours because you begged me to. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you, a fee of mine, your brother or sister from the heart. A fee of mine means to release, to let go. You know, it's obviously it's often used, as we just read, in the sense of a debt. You've got something that there's a debt and you say, I forgive that debt. I let it go. That is forgiveness. That's what we need to do in our marriage. We let go. You know, we don't hold on. We don't hold that debt there until you pay it off. Like Ange said, sometimes they're like, you got to pay this debt off. You don't know what you've done. And when you're done paying it off, then it's all, we're all even. Well, that's not really forgiveness. We have a phiamai. The other one is charismai. Charismai, charis, it's close to grace. Where we get the word grace, it's different. It really means it's kind of unconditional. It's this unbestowed favor like grace, but it's 2 Corinthians 2:7 gives us an idea how to use it. It says, now instead you ought to charismai, forgive and comfort him so that he will not be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. Anyone you charismai, I also forgive. And what I have forgiven, if there is anything to forgive, I have forgiven in the sight of Christ for your sake. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you, like we read about before. It's different types, it's different ideas. You know, we pour out grace. Sometimes there is no apology. And we're going to talk about that in a moment also. But he says charisma is the sense of it's unconditional. It's not based on the perfect apology, not based on that. Sometimes it's I'm not going to hold on to this debt. I'm going to let it go. So forgiveness is an act of your will. Also, forgiveness, and hear this before you run off and go, what is he talking about? Forgiveness is not forgetting. That's passive. Okay, that's like, I just forgot. I can't even remember. I was going to forgive you, but I forgot what you did. Forgiveness is, consider this, is this active, ongoing process. You go, what about God? That's what you're thinking right now. Yeah, what about God? Well, it says in Isaiah 43, verse 25, God says, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and remembers your sins no more. God is not saying that he can't remember them. I was trying to remember what they were, and I forgot. You know, I'm getting old. I've been around forever. He's decided to not remember them. It's this ongoing process. It may be a daily decision. Some of us understand that. You know, like if we're really deeply hurt, I'm not saying this in any great way, but I've never felt so hurt by Ange. I had to think out every day, maybe a few days, maybe I felt just the emotions wearing down, but nothing so bad. But there is some hurts in marriages.
I genuinely am sorry.
What are you sorry about specifically?
I am sorry for the way I made you feel. I take responsibility for the way I make you feel.
Thank you. I feel so much better. The thing is, there may be, in some marriages, there may be deep, deep hurt that you have to work at it. It's an ongoing process. It's not simply forgetting. Sorry, I'm getting to our next verse here. No, not our next verse. Forgiveness is not excusing. It's not saying, just forget about it. No, nothing ever happened. By the very idea that it demands forgiveness, you're not excusing it. You're saying that someone has been wronged and there needs to be forgiveness. And like Angie said, it's hard to say, it's hard to say that I'm sorry, or it's hard to say I'm wrong. It's also sometimes hard to say, I forgive you.
Yeah.
But in a marriage, those are good words and ones that we need.
So I wanted to ask you a question.
Yes.
So
don't make it difficult.
So if your spouse tells you you're sorry, if you just don't feel ready to forgive them, like right then?
like, do it anyway. No, I do believe that as emotional beings, we need time sometimes.
So it's okay to go, I just need some space.
I need
time
some
to
space.
Think about
I
it.
I need some time.
And then come back.
Yeah, the Bible says, don't let the sun go down in your anger. Don't
settle matters quickly. Yeah.
Yeah, Hebrews 12 says, don't let a bitter root get started. So you don't let it go on and on and on. You don't go out. It's hard to go out and pray because it says, leave your gift. So I'm going.
But you don't
have
to forgive on the spot right there.
I don't. You should if you can, if you are able, if you are physically able. No, if you're able, I think it's good. But the more time goes by, the more challenging it gets.
Yeah, it's true.
And in the end, it is simply, not simply, it's a very difficult one, but it is a decision of your will. I will forgive. But also, it's costly. So think about this. Forgiveness, when you forgive, you know, the phiomai, you absorb a debt. You absorb it. You absorb the wrong. You absorb a certain aspect of your spouse's sin or what they've done against you. Mm. And you're releasing them from what they owe you. But you absorb it. And that's part of love. That's part of building a great, phenomenal relationship. You know, I've definitely heard Angie over the years. And when we've reconciled, and I know I've hurt her and she's forgiven me, it's made me not want to forgive her again. And when you reconcile, it should urge you to go, I don't want to do this again.
No, you said it makes me not want to forgive her again. Well,
that's what I meant. I don't want to hurt her again. That's what I meant.
It took me a second to catch that.
Jeez. How things could get twisted, huh? What are some other things about forgiveness? Well, our attitude should be, I will not think about this incident. I will not bring up this incident again and use it against you. I will not talk to others about this incident. If you've said I've forgiven your spouse, why run and talk to everybody about it? If you can, if you have to work through it, yeah, get some help and guidance. I will not allow this incident to stand between us or hinder our personal relationship. I'm not going to continue to think about this. Now, that's what I said. It's an ongoing process. Sometimes you have to do that every day. I'm not going to think about this. I'm going to pray about it. Every time I start to think about it, I'm going to start to pray for my spouse, him or her, and how much I love them or for our relationship. I'm not going to bring it up again and use it against them. I'm not going to talk to others and not allow this incident to stand between us. I'm not going to have the cold shoulder. That's true forgiveness. Well, you know, you think about, when should I forgive? Well, Luke 17 3 through 5 says, when your brother sins against you, forgive him. And says, I've sinned, you know, forgive him. Well, what if he does it 7 times a day? Forgive him. Not 7, but 7 times 77. A perfect number, perfect forgiveness, you know. It should hopefully in a marriage, like Ann shared, after an apology, then there should be reconciliation, forgiveness. There should be forgiveness and reconciliation coming together. Challenge is things don't always work out in a perfect world in that way. Mm. I think there's two types of forgiveness when you think about it. There's positional forgiveness. This is unconditional forgiveness that you make a commitment before God. What verses? Well, Mark 11:25, you see it right here. When you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. Stephen, it says in Acts 7, verse 60, then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he had said this, he fell asleep. So in Mark 11 there, I'm leaving up there for a second. If you're praying, and is this after everyone? Does the verse before say, after everyone has said, I repent, will you forgive me? I apologize. I'm sorry. It's sincere. And then you go out and you start praying. Now let it know that this is a position. This is, I will make the decision to forgive them. Again, it's a decision to not dwell on the incident. I'm not going to seek to get back at my spouse. You know, what does that do? Well, maybe your spouse isn't apologizing. Maybe they don't see it. Maybe they're not a Christian. Maybe they're harsh. Maybe they're doing the same thing over and over again. You got to protect your heart from bitterness, from resentment. And Jesus said, when you stand praying, if you've got anything against anyone, you let it go. You forgive your spouse. And finally, there's also transactional forgiveness. What's that? Because if somebody messes you up in a transaction, sorry, God did both of these. First one would be the positional. Jesus is hanging on the cross. He says, Father, forgive them. Really? Did they repent? No, for they do not know what they're doing. Acts 2:37 says, when the people heard this, they were cut to heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that, or for the forgiveness of your sins, you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So in that sense, that's the Luke 17. When your spouse says, I'm sorry. Ultimately, that's what you want. But we don't have to have a sorry. If we had to wait for everyone to say, I'm sorry, what if they, sadly, say drove off a cliff before they could say they're sorry? That would be horrible.
Yeah,
it would be terrible. What do? You go, I hold on to this forever, you know, or run to the bottom of the cliff. That doesn't make sense. But you understand what I'm saying. The point is, we can forgive. We can be in a position anywhere, anytime, before we go out and pray, to stand before God and say, if I hold anything, I'm going to let it go. I will let anything, any way that my spouse has hurt me, I will make a decision to let it go. I'll absorb that debt. I'll let God, to let them go of that liability. You know, in closing, we've got to be, we have to have the heart of God to really have a great marriage. And part of that is being able to forgive. Amen. God doesn't have to apologize ever. We have to apologize. I have to apologize a lot. But God doesn't ever have to. But God's heart is He always wants to forgive. Let's in our marriages, let's be the first. Let's seek out to be the one to lead the way in humility and apologize. To lead the way in grace and forgive. And let's do whatever it takes to, in our marriages, to be reconciled. Angie and I have, some of you who know us, I saw Floyd Grissett's name come up there. Floyd, you know, we've had some big old fights, Angie and I, as the years have gone by. I've gotten less and less and less and less, thank you, God. But one thing we do is we fight for complete and total reconciliation, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, absolutely. I feel like it's hard to move on if I don't feel completely reconciled, even about little things, not just the big things. So, yeah, it's very important.
Guys, thank you so much for being with us. And we'll be back at another time with something else to talk about. But
yes,
we felt like this
was important. We are working on another series, and we will let you know about it. But it's been definitely awesome being with you these past 8 weeks, just even going through the pandemic and being able to share our lives, and you share yours with us, and for us to really go through them together, because this pandemic has definitely affected our marriages, hopefully for the better, because of all the time we've been able to spend together. But we look forward to a new series. And if you have any thoughts and ideas, definitely let us know. But thank you.
We love you.
We love you guys. Thank you.
Have a great night.
Bye-bye.